So hello, my name is Tian-Tian He, and I'm interviewing Gwendolyn Wu for the Houston Asian American Archive on May 22nd, 2020. So first off, where and when were you born?
Yeah, so I was born February 15th, 1997 in Northridge, California. It's a suburb of Los Angeles, and my parents immigrated there in the early 1990s, about a decade and a half after they immigrated from Vietnam.
Okay. So they immigrated from Vietnam. Did they land first in a different place?
Yeah. So my parents both took pretty different routes coming out of Asia. They both were born in Saigon. My mom fled in 1979. She went first with her family to Pulau Midong in Malaysia. It was this island with about like 100 to 200,000 Vietnamese, Thai, and Laos refugees. And then after that, they got sponsored by an American family to go to Philadelphia first. She landed in Philadelphia in 1979. And then in, I believe it was 1992, my mom left Philadelphia for Los Angeles because she had met my dad. My dad fled Vietnam in 1981, I believe. He and his family went to Hong Kong first for about 6 months. After that, he was sponsored. One of my uncles and one of my aunts were sponsored to move to Dallas. And then after Dallas, he left for Los Angeles because that's where part of his family was sent. And then he and my mom met through a mutual friend over the phone, actually. And then they settled in Los Angeles full time after that.
Okay. So how old were they when they fled Vietnam?
Okay, this might take a little math. My mom was, I believe, 23 or 26 when she left Saigon. My dad was nearly 30 when he left.
Okay. And what was the process like for getting a sponsorship?
I'm trying to remember if my parents ever told me about this. I asked my parents a lot of questions about this. It's a pretty inquisitive kid. Sometimes my parents would answer, other times they would not. But if I remember correctly, part of it for my mom's side of the family was because my grandfather had owned and operated a club that largely serviced American servicemen during the war in Central Vietnam who would go back home every few months or so. And so he had some connections with American military officers. And so that was, if I remember correctly, when they fled to Pulau Bidong, he mentioned that he had worked with the Americans. And so it seemed, in some sense, from what my mom's side of the family has told me, that they were able to get a little bit of priority because they had previously aided American servicemen. For my dad, I think it was a little different. He had been saving money anyway. He was working as a day laborer in Hong Kong in early 1981, and so he was just trying to save up funds to just buy a ticket out of Asia. I don't exactly know how he got sponsored to come to the U.S., but I do know that he ended up getting resettled in Dallas.
Okay, wow. I saw on your survey thing that you speak Cantonese. So are your parents Cantonese?
Yes. My parents, it's kind of funny. Both of my grandparents, all four of my grandparents lived in, for the most part, grew up in Vietnam. My grandfather and my great-grandmother fled from, I believe it was Fujian or Fuzhou, somewhere in there in China when he was a little boy. He resettled when he was young. And my grandfather on my dad's side grew up in Hainan, and so he also fled to Vietnam kind of during the civil unrest in China in the early 1900s. So as far as I know, both my grandfathers are Chinese and both my grandmothers are Vietnamese. Paternal grandmother is, I believe, mixed Chinese and Vietnamese, so she spoke both a Chinese dialect and a Vietnamese dialect. And then kind of down the line, I think it's easier for me a lot of the time to just say, yes, I'm half Chinese and half Vietnamese. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so they spoke, what language did they speak at home?
They spoke, so on my mom's side, my grandfather spoke Cantonese, Cantonese and Vietnamese and a little bit of Mandarin. Or actually, I think he was fluent in Mandarin. My grandmother only spoke Vietnamese on my mom's side. On my dad's side, both my grandfather and my grandmother spoke Hokkienese. Wait, no. Was it Hokkienese? No, Hainanese. They both spoke Hainanese, and they both spoke Vietnamese as well. My dad learned Mandarin. I'm not sure if that was something that he learned attending a Chinese school in Vietnam, or if it was something that he picked up from his parents. But he speaks Mandarin and Cantonese as well. So does my mother.
Mm-hmm. So was it hard to like pick up all those languages?
Yes. Oh my God. When I was a kid, I was like, I'm going to learn all the languages.
Oh my God.
Fast forward, you know, 20 some odd years, I really only speak Cantonese, English, a little bit of Mandarin. I'm like proficient enough to hold a conversation pretty quickly, but I'm not like by any means good at writing it, good at really having long, complicated conversations with people about it. I understand Vietnamese. I don't really speak it. And I also like understand the occasional word in Phokkienese, which is my maternal grandfather's dialect.
Mm-hmm. That's cool that you were so motivated to do it, because like I know a lot of kids are super resistant to like learning their native language.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Like my parents, I think it really helped that I grew up in a multi-generational household. Both my maternal grandparents lived with me as a kid. So I used to speak Vietnamese fluently when I was a kid, but as I got older, I really kind of forgot it because I didn't really communicate as much with my grandparents. There is that. And then my parents did somewhat, well, willingly on their part, unwillingly on my part, send me to Mandarin Chinese school when I was a kid, which is how I picked up the language there. And we speak Cantonese at home. And so that's how my parents were able to get me to be fluent in Cantonese and in English.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. Would you happen to know what were the biggest challenges that they faced in immigrating?
That's a good question. I think the challenges really came before and really a little bit after when they settled here. It's interesting, actually. The research project I worked on when I was an undergraduate studying history at UC Santa Barbara was about the persecution of ethnically Chinese Vietnamese residents right before the war. And so that was very much so kind of born out of what my parents had taught me. Both my parents faced discrimination in the Vietnamese higher education system. They went to a secondary school, I guess. They went to a secondary school that was predominantly a Catholic school aimed at teaching ethnic Chinese Vietnamese. And so for them, both my parents, neither of them were able to get access to Vietnamese colleges and universities because they were ethnically Chinese. And that was the same kind of discrimination they faced as well, kind of getting jobs. My parents wanted to save money to move to the U.S., and they went to the same school. They just didn't really meet until they got to the U.S. So for them, it was very much so, you know, not having the capital, being persecuted. Both my parents, fled Vietnam not willingly. For my mom's side, you know, she very much, her family very much so knew that they had kind of a target on their back because they were ethnically Chinese. And actually, the day after they fled Saigon from Malaysia, it turned out that, well, my grandmother had stayed behind at a friend's house, and the government came and raided their family, their properties afterward. Same thing for my dad's side. He knew he had a target on his back. He was actually at the fall of Saigon, He had made it his way up to the rooftop where American servicemen were taking troops and the few Vietnamese refugees they could out of the country. And he was unwilling to go because he had six siblings and none of them were with him that day. And he didn't want to be the person who left without taking his family alongside. Mm-hmm. Afterwards, for my mom, when she went to Malaysia, she fled by boat. And so she was with some relatives. Alicia was with her sister, her cousin, my grandfather, and a few other relatives. I remember her telling me it was about a week-long boat journey. It was pretty terrifying for her because there were pirates on the seas at the time, and so they were trying to seize any gold, any cash that they could find. And I remember my mom detailing to me the struggles of, like, you know, my grandmother had had sewn American currency into their jeans, and they were wearing several layers of clothing to hide all the gold and the jewelry that they had taken with them, and a lot of it just being terrified that the boat was going to sink when they were there. For my dad, who also fled by boat to Hong Kong, you know, for him, one of the just more terrifying things was, like, yes, he was going to make it to Hong Kong. He's fairly certain he could, because he fled, you know, 2 or 3 years after most of the unrest in Vietnam during the time. But trying to get to the U.S. was very much so a struggle, because my dad was lower middle class, didn't have a whole lot of cash that could buy him a plane ticket or anything to the U.S. And so he and several of his siblings worked a lot. I remember my dad describing to me, he slept in this Hong Kong flat that was like 8 by 10 feet or something like that. And, you know, just kind of, you know, head to foot with his siblings, because that was all they could afford at the time. And they needed to save as much money as they could to get to the U.S.
So for them, was the U.S. kind of like a dream place, like the ultimate place that they wanted to go?
It's interesting. I've asked my parents that question several times, and both my parents' answer was just kind of like, you know, we're willing to resettle anywhere that's willing to have us.
Okay.
A lot of my family got split up. My mom's sister got sent to the U.S. with her, but my mom's sister's boyfriend, my uncle, later to be my uncle, was resettled in Taiwan and then in Australia later on. My aunts and uncles on my dad's side got sent to Toronto after the war. So, you know, they had heard really good things about the U.S., you know, City of Gold. They're hearing that it's so beautiful here. And of course, they'd heard very similar things about Australia and Canada as well, but, you know, the U.S. was very much so built up to be a land of opportunity and promises for them. So they were just kind of like, you know, yeah, sure, we'll be resettled anywhere, but if we're going to get sent to the U.S., that's great. So,
Were they ever able to, like, reunite with their siblings?
Yeah, so I count my family pretty fortunate. All my parents' siblings made it out of Vietnam, as did a lot of their extended relatives. I would say that the majority of my extended family ended up getting resettled in Canada, and they were able to kind of establish ties, and then, you know, later communication. So yeah, I have family members who live in Sydney, Australia. I have family members who live in Toronto, Canada. A lot of my mom's closest extended family got resettled in the Philadelphia and New Jersey area. And so for the most part, they've been able to stay in touch. They regularly try to see each other, try to do phone calls. Now that we're in like a very technological age, a lot of FaceTiming. So yeah.
Nice. Okay. What were their jobs when they came to the U.S., and do they have the same jobs now?
So my mom, when she arrived in Philadelphia, she was still fairly young. She wanted to get enrolled in college here, but they were telling her she didn't have the English proficiency to do so. So my mom attended about a few months of high school, then went to community college, and then enrolled at Temple University in Philadelphia. She got her degree in accounting, and then she did some time as a some kind of clerk, I believe, for a local court in Pennsylvania. And then after that, when she left Philadelphia, she worked in retail for a little bit when she got to Los Angeles. And then just 2 years ago, she retired as a receptionist from a dentist practice here. A dentist practice in Los Angeles. My dad, when he got here, did a very similar thing. He tried to enroll in adult school English proficiency courses. He got his certifications as in a trade. I don't exactly know what he did. I feel like it was related to welding or something like that. But he had pretty technical jobs his whole life. For most of my dad's life in the U.S., he worked as a busboy for a little bit at a restaurant, and then he went on to become a technician of some sort at a manufacturing company in the suburbs of L.A. He worked his way up to a lower-level management position before he was laid off in the 2010s, started a company of his own for a little bit, and then he retired I think a couple of years ago. He still does like odds and ends, like handyman jobs here and there, but for the most part, both my parents are retired.
Okay. Congratulations to them. That's pretty early.
Thanks. Yeah, my parents are definitely older. They had me pretty late in life. Okay. So I think that was probably why they were like, well, you know, we're approaching 65. Okay. You know, it's time for us to retire. So I was just like, okay, cool. So.
Yeah. Are they religious?
Not really much. I think it's funny. Both my parents went to Catholic school in Vietnam. I think it made them extremely dedicated agnostics and atheists. They do adhere to Buddhism. I'd say it's like a guiding philosophical principle for both my parents, but it's not very much so religious. However, my mom does drag me to temple every time I go home and visit them. So there is that, and they do celebrate like ancestral holidays, Buddhist holidays, observe vegetarianism on some of those days. And they do make an effort to go to temple at least once a month, and just, you know, offerings for the ancestors, prayers at the altar. So.
Mm-hmm. And do you like keep any of those beliefs? Are you religious now?
Personally, no. I don't know. It never really convinced me as a kid. I think my parents were very much so like, you know, make your own decisions. If you don't believe in something, you don't believe in something. And they never really pushed Buddhism on me as a kid either. I remember, you know, I grew up with a Buddhist altar in my house, and I never really paid much attention to it, although my grandmother and my mom were very philosophical and a little bit religious in that sense. But for the most part, my mom has to remind me to pray at the Buddhist altar before I leave when I go home and visit them.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so how much did your parents try to assimilate versus maintaining their culture?
What I always thought was really fascinating about my parents, I remember asking my mom once why they chose to move to the suburb of Los Angeles that they live in. My family lives in the San Fernando Valley in LA. It's about 30 minutes north of downtown on a good day without traffic. I was always wondering why they chose to move there as opposed to the San Gabriel Valley, which is a very large ethnic Asian enclave, mm-hmm. About 20 minutes east of downtown Los Angeles. Honestly, the answer my mom gave me was, there are just so many Asian people there. We wanted you to grow up somewhere that was actually very diverse. And the neighborhoods that I grew up in the San Fernando Valley were very much so that, you know, my parents' neighbors back home are white, Latino, and Asian. I appreciate that about my parents, that they were kind of like, you know, we don't necessarily want you to assimilate, but we don't want you to feel like you're going to grow up in a community that is very monolithic, and they didn't want me to only know Chinese American culture. At the same time, though, I think my parents tried to have a very kind of blended upbringing of both Chinese and American culture. My mom taught me Cantonese as the first language, and I enrolled technically as an English as a second language student when I was in elementary school, but I picked up English pretty fast. I would say my mom didn't really shy away from like cooking me Asian food to take to school, but both my parents were working, and so sometimes it would just be easier for her to be like, you know, we're just going to buy pre-made, ready-made American foods at the grocery store, and you're just going to take those to school. My parents sent me to Chinese school every Saturday from when I was 4 to when I was 16. So they really wanted me to have some kind of tie to the culture that I was, you know, I was born into and I was raised in. And, you know, they always made sure that if we were going to celebrate some sort of major holiday, such as Chinese New Year, I had goods to bring into school and be like, hey, like, you know, it's Chinese New Year. We have these red lucky candies. Use these to give to the kids and be like, here's a little symbol of luck. Make sure that your classmates know what this is. And I always found that my teachers were very respectful of that. The other kids, not so much. There were definitely times where I brought Vietnamese food to school and it stunk up my locker, and the kids around me didn't really understand that that's yeah. what certain foods smell and taste like. So I definitely have a lunchbox story in that sense.
The classic
lunchbox story. But other than that, my parents are very much so like, you know, we want you to behave as if this was a melting pot. You know, we don't want your culture to disappear. So maybe not melting pot, but maybe a little bit more of a salad, where, you know, we want you to be proud and able to say you're Chinese, Vietnamese, American, but still understand that there are a lot of cultures around you that you could stand to benefit and learn about.
Yeah. So kind of like related, what kind of community did your parents have in California? Because I read your Asian auntie article.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, who are these aunties?
The aunties, yes, the ever-present aunties. Yeah, my parents, like I said, I grew up in a pretty diverse suburb. My neighbors were white, Latino, and Asian. But every 2 weeks or so, we would make a pilgrimage down to Chinatown, the San Gabriel Valley. My mom insists to this day that they are fresher groceries than the American supermarkets that we grew up near. But for the most part, my mom really reinforced that behavior. You know, you go every few weeks to stock up on Asian vegetables. You go to temple. You go get your services done out there. Very much so, my parents tried to, and still do to some degree to this day, rely on services predominantly in the Asian American community. My parents were always going to be more comfortable taking me to a doctor that spoke Chinese than sending me to a doctor who only spoke English. And so they, I would say, tried very hard to seek out services that were, you know, culturally in their comfort zone. They stayed very connected to the community by always kind of picking up Asian newspapers when we were out in Chinatown in the San Gabriel Valley, just so they could really stay afloat of what was going on out there. Some of my parents, friends and family immigrated to the San Gabriel Valley and other parts of Southern California, so we were also able to visit them a lot. My mom definitely stayed in touch with a lot of her friends growing up over the phone as well, no matter whether or not they were settled in Hong Kong settled just 20 miles south of us. So very much so they spent their time largely among the Asian community, but they weren't afraid or they weren't hesitant to go seek out services in a predominantly English-speaking community if that was what was available to them.
Mm-hmm. So what influence did the people in like your parents' circle have on you as a child? Were you able to interact with them?
Yeah, it's funny because my mom always like, you know, criticized parents who very strictly parented their kids.
Oh.
You know, the so-called tiger mom parenting style.
Yeah.
And my mom never really wanted me to be like that. I described her once as a cheetah mom to one of my teachers. Like, you know, very much so, like, you need to succeed and you need to go to college, but we're not going to sit here and take away your computer if you get a B instead of an A kind of parents. My mom and my dad taught me to be proud of the culture that I was raised in and to never be afraid to say I identify as Asian American, I identify as Chinese or Vietnamese. And I think that a lot of that came from, you know, two things. One thing being that they were still very close with their relatives and friends who had immigrated from Vietnam with them, and they were able to frequently see them. The other part being that my parents had me a lot later in life than many of their relatives and their friends did. And so by the point that I was born and I started gaining consciousness as a child and a young adult, my mom was seeing a lot of her friends' kids either completely disregard the culture that they were raised in, or forget the language that they were born speaking, get rid of Asian food in favor of American food. So my mom always wanted me to be the kind of kid who would be able to come back and say, hey, mom, I'm really craving your cooking. Or, you know, when I call my mom on the phone, even though now she's 2,000 miles away from me, I speak in fluent Cantonese for the most part of it when we are on the phone for an hour. My mom never wanted me to be like one of those kids because she never wanted me to forget that I identify as Asian American first. So.
Okay. So those kids, did they have like tiger moms that overwhelmed them and they just kind of rejected it?
Yeah, it was definitely that. Some of them, some of the relatives and friends, you know, they were just working a lot and Yeah. They didn't actively parent their kids as much as my mom did. My parents have the added benefit of having my grandparents around to help raise me. So there was that. But I think that my mom saw what was happening with her friend's kids, and she was just kind of disappointed in her own way that they rejected a lot of Chinese and Vietnamese culture, and she didn't really want to have the same judgment, I think, passed down on her. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah. What are the most valuable things besides that you learned from your upbringing?
I really feel like one of the biggest things that my parents passed down that's very much so like a Chinese American cultural value is hard work. My parents were middle class to lower middle class growing up in Vietnam, and so they understood when they were found out that they were going to the U.S. or that they were thinking about having a better life for themselves outside of Vietnam. They wanted to live somewhere where hard work was going to be what got you stability, financial means in the future. Unfortunately, American society does not always work that way. But I will say that value of hard work was something that my parents instilled in me since I was a little kid. And so that, I think, has really driven me to try so hard to succeed, to work so hard, and to get to a place where I've been and where I am now. I don't think that I would have had the opportunities that I'd had if my parents hadn't pushed me from being a little kid to work hard. They were like, you're not always going to get an A, but if you work hard, you'll have made your best attempt at mm-hmm. getting that. And, that on top of always being proud of identifying as Chinese American, Vietnamese American, Asian American, that has all, those things have always stuck with me.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so then moving on to school, what was elementary school like for you?
Yeah, so my parents actually enrolled me at the local elementary school. It was, if I remember correctly, a predominantly Latino school. And also it was a school that didn't always have a whole lot of financial resources. To be fair, it might just be the school district I grew up in. I went to a school in LAUSD, which is one of the largest, if not the largest school district in the country. And so I grew up very much so used to having to take furlough days because there wasn't enough money to pay the teachers. And my school wasn't really highly regarded as some of the other schools in our district were. When I was in first grade, I was very fortunate to have had a teacher that looked out for me. And she suggested to my mom and the principal that I skip a grade. Mm-hmm. And so 2 months into first grade, they were like, hey, okay, you're going to second grade now because you know how to spell Mississippi. And I was like, okay, cool. And then I realized, oh God, I have no friends. I adjusted very well because I had very supportive first and second grade teachers who just made sure I was caught up academically. School came pretty easy to me as a kid. So that transition wasn't too bad at all. Around that time in second grade, they tested me for what LAUSD called the Highly Gifted Program, which is just basically the IQ test, but they did it by a different criteria. So I tested as highly gifted. To this day, I do not understand what the percentiles they gave me actually mean. There's a whole lot of sociological and psychological literature about how the phrase highly gifted might have left me with a lot of baggage, but that's a problem for later. So there was that. My mom tried really hard to get me as many academic opportunities as I could. I think that was partially why they enrolled me in Chinese school as well, was like, we want you to be able to demonstrate mastery of another language. My mom tried to tutor me after school as well. She'd leave me worksheets on like multiplication tables and spelling and practicing cursive. And she tried to enroll me in other schools when it was possible. She tried to enroll me in a magnet school, which were originally invented for the purpose of integrating suburban schools in Los Angeles and other major cities, but very much so morphed to become like specialty schools where kids were given more opportunities, more dedicated teachers, that kind of stuff. So I wasn't able to get into those schools because the lottery system didn't work out that way, but instead my mom really just kind of pushed me to learn as much outside of school as I could. She really encouraged my reading habit, which I think led to a writing hobby and then later on a writing career. Mm-hmm. But she also encouraged me to learn as much about the world as I could, so.
Yeah, so who were your closest childhood friends?
For the most part, when I was a kid, so I actually met my first best friend on a playground in our little suburb in the San Fernando Valley. Her name is Stephanie. She is a Vietnamese American. and she and I kept in touch. We haven't been extremely close since elementary school, but we actually still text each other pretty frequently. She still lives in our childhood neighborhood, and she'll text me when she's like, "Hey, I saw your parents on a walk the other day." She actually texted me the other day to be like, "Hey, your dad actually stayed 6 feet away and he was wearing a mask. How did you get him to do that?" And I was like, "That is a great question." A lot of texting back and forth with my parents. I also largely hung out with an Asian American group of friends in elementary school. I don't know if my parents have still like said outright to me like, "Hey, go seek out Asian American friends." But I think it was easy for me to relate to them because they were people that looked familiar to me. Yeah. I had a pretty good core group of friends in elementary school who were predominantly Vietnamese. I had a few close friends who were Latina and Filipino as well. And then later on in middle school, I kind of tried to expand that circle a little bit. I had friends who identified as Mexican, Persian, Korean, Chinese, Vietnamese, Black, White. And so I really kind of took, I think, both my parents' message really to kind of look for good people no matter what race they identify as. But I think it also very much so reflected, you know, my parents exactly didn't force that kind of language onto me. And also, you know, I met people who I felt fit in with me. And I think kind of subconsciously sought out, you know, fellow people of color and very much so fellow Asian Americans.
Mm-hmm. So in middle school, was that like a conscious decision? Where you're like, "I want like more diverse friends"?
That is a good question. I've wondered this definitely. So I got sent to a predominantly white and Asian school in middle school, very much so like a academically gifted type of school. So most of the people who were enrolled in my classes were white and Asian people. However, I mean, the thing about middle school and the thing about mean girls in middle school is that when you aren't popular, you're not exactly hanging out with the super well-off white and Asian kids or hanging out with other folks who are like, "Yeah, we just kind of got lucky and our parents enrolled us in this school" kind of kids. So the friends I made, you know, we all sat alphabetically together. And so I think that's how I made a lot of my friends who were, you know, not necessarily Asian. They had similar last names. They didn't have similar last names, excuse me. But, you know, we were all kind of always at the bottom of the alphabet. Not always the popular kids in school kind of people. And I think it just kind of was happenstance in a way that they were more diverse than a lot of the people that I've met. Like I said, wasn't really popular in middle school. And for the most part, the people who were popular in middle school were white and fairly well off. And so I think kind of by a miracle of social aid classes, just you can get in middle school. And the people I'd met in my classes, I really ended up hanging out with a lot of Asian, Latino, and Black classmates.
Mm-hmm. So as a child, young teenager, what did you like to do for fun?
Really into dolls when I was in elementary school and dress up. I always thought I was going to end up like doing like, I don't know, like I had a lot of like dream career paths when I was a kid, and I always tried to make my like hobbies and my what I considered fun reflect that. But the one big thing that really stuck with me, especially from like the ages of, you know, like 9 to 14, was I thought I was going to be a writer. I thought I was going to be an author. And so really fun for me was always reading and writing. I tried so hard and failed miserably many times to write novels when I was a kid. What I always found so fun was just that you could create a whole world. You could create characters. You could create whole lines of thinking that didn't actually reflect what was going on in your life. I got bullied quite a bit at the beginning of middle school, and so that really became like an escape for me to be able to create this world where I was no longer the person getting bullied. I was the person at the top of the food chain, or I was the person who was well off, or was popular and had friends and all that stuff. That kind of translated itself because when I was in late elementary school, early middle school, my parents got a computer with stable internet, and I spent a lot of time reading fan fiction of my favorite books when I was a kid. It's funny because, like, now as an adult, I'm like, am I allowed to say that I read a lot of fan fiction? Because I used to keep that a secret when I was a kid. But I read a lot of fan fiction of Harry Potter, of which was a big favorite book series back then, Gossip Girl, The Chronicles of Narnia. And I also subsequently found communities where people like to co-write fiction, people like to pretend that they were those characters. I think it sounds weird to me now, because I'm like, that isn't really like a popular pastime by any sense. But what was so fun to me was just like, you got to pretend you were a different person for a while. And the other thing being that oftentimes the people I met in those communities took just as much an interest in Asian culture and what I could bring to the table as much as whatever they brought to the table as well. I love writing because I found so many like-minded people on the internet and had these communities that I could go back to and be like, hey, today I'm going to pretend to be this character at a boarding school whose big secret is that she's a shoplifter or something like that. And it was really a fun way to be creative with the amount of internet time that I was allocated as a kid. So.
Okay, that's amazing. I think I'm pretty sure I did the same thing, like pretending to be characters on forums and stuff.
Yeah.
So many questions. What, like, you said you wrote novels. What were these about?
So one of the big novels, that I remember writing as a kid, I remember when I was 8 or 9 or so, I tried to write a fairy tale about a princess and a prince sibling who wanted to go on adventures, but their father was super restrictive and wouldn't let them go anywhere, so they had to learn to create things on their own inside their homes. Some would say I wrote the plot of Frozen before it was Frozen. But that aside, I felt a lot of strong bonds to my friends when I was a kid, specifically the friends that I made in middle school, because, for the first time, I knew so many people that came from such diverse backgrounds, and I always found their life stories really fascinating. Middle school is also just an angsty time in general, and you just want to vent out all of your feelings on a piece of paper. So, I mean, I read stories where we were the popular kids, where, no longer was I the one getting bullied or my friends the one getting bullied. I wrote one story, and I was actually talking to my boyfriend about this a few days ago, about how one story I wrote when I was in middle school was about, I was such a big nerd at the time too, was reimagining the European royal history from about the Queen Victoria era within colonial Asia instead.
Whoa.
And just, seeing like what would have happened if, say, for example, the imperial dynasty in Vietnam had done something similar to what Queen Victoria did and married off all their children to different countries rather than closing off and having wars. I think we would have seen a way more unified Asia rather than what you're seeing now and what you saw kind of in the 1900s. I was a very big nerd. I am one of those people who reads Wikipedia for fun. And that was very much so what I did when I was a young teenager. So a lot of my stories really kind of reflect that, my curiosities about the world and history applied to storylines and characters that I tweaked, but were really just thinly veiled versions of my friends in real life.
Mm. Okay, cool. And what was my other question? Okay, what were your favorite books?
Oh man, I got asked this question once at a job interview and I was just like, I'm gonna need like 6 minutes to think this out, but the good news is I remember my answer from then. Harry Potter has always been one of my favorite book series. I got the first two books as a gift from one of my aunts when I was a very little kid. there's so someone takes magic seriously, an adult takes magic seriously. I love the Chronicles of Narnia. Another big book influence on me when I was a kid was the Click series, which is about rich middle school girls in Westchester County, New York. But what it was a validation of all the mean girl behavior and consumerism. But now as an adult, I'm like, this is troubling that this is my favorite book series. But yeah, Gossip Girl, the Privilege series, is very much so. It's young adult chick literature. I've actually got really nerdy and really into like nonfiction psychological books when I was in late middle school, but I wouldn't say by any means any of them were like favorite books. My parents always really encouraged me to read. I love the Babysitter's Club and the Boxcar Children series when I was a kid. And my parents always took me to the libraries in LA County, and I would just like go like rummage through all of the used bookstore sales and come home with stacks and stacks of books. My parents actually a couple of years ago cleaned out my room, and they were like, why do you own hundreds of books? And I'm like, I have a hoarding problem, and I never let go of any of the books I loved as a kid. But definitely, like, my favorite ones were always, you know, ones where the kids go on adventures, or slice of life books, where it's like, this is just what life is like for these young girls who started a babysitting club in New England or something like that.
Yeah, like, really immersive.
Definitely, and, like, especially fiction, it's just like, you know, you could tell such a meaningful story that told you, well, this is what American life is really like in just 100 words, or not 100 words, 100 pages or something like that.
And so how big of a part did the internet play in your, like, growing up?
I don't think I really got on the internet, so to speak, until, like, I was 10 or 11. I don't know if it was just that my parents didn't want to buy a computer quite yet, or it wasn't really, like, the necessary thing in the suburbs where we lived until I got to middle school or so. I feel like my parents got very stable internet access when I was about 10 or 11. And then I was kind of at this weird stage where I didn't really have a whole lot of friends those first few years in middle school, that I wasn't spending my free time hanging out with my friends. And my parents were older. You know, I didn't feel like it was appropriate, or like I thought it was too cool for dress up and dolls. My parents didn't really get me involved in any sports at that time. So I really turned to the internet as an outlet and spent, like, you know, hours a day on the internet, starting from when I was about 11 or 12 or so. Really got into Neopets when I was in that stage of my life. Like, I would just spend hours on the forums there, talking to people, making my pets pretty and stuff like that. And after that, you know, really turned a lot to fan fiction, turned a lot to online communities where I could still chat with other people in real life. But, you know, I would pretend to be another character. I would say the internet swallowed up a lot of my life. I would spend hours and hours a day just for fun on the forums and stuff like that, from about when I was like 11 to when I was about 14. And after that point in high school, the internet became yet again, you know, a slightly different outlet, but very much so a place I spent hours and hours a day, because I used to play League of Legends and other games with my friends a lot. That has definitely changed since I entered college and became a working adult. You know, the internet is now, oh God, I already spent 8 hours of my day on a screen.
Yeah.
I really want to spend more, but social media has made it pretty hard to stay off.
Yeah. How do you think your life would have changed if you hadn't, like, spent all that time on forums and, like, online things when you were young?
My brain probably would have been better. But that aside, I think it stuck to me for a little while, because, you know, developing social skills on the internet is a lot different than developing social skills in person. My parents fortunately lightened up a little bit on their rules once I was in middle school, and I was allowed to go over to a couple friends' houses pretty frequently, as long as my parents met them beforehand and knew them. So that helped, but I mean, for one, I think I would have developed healthier habits. You know, nowadays I could easily spend like 6 to 7 hours on a computer without thinking about it, you know, and not even doing anything productive in particular. Like, I could literally just scroll Reddit for like 4 or 5 hours and be like, oh, great, I have sucked up my time. So, developed better social skills, definitely had better grades, especially in high school once I started gaming a lot. This is a fun story I have to tell, like, high schoolers who are, like, freaking out about my grades, but, like, I played so much League of Legends when I was in junior year of high school. All my parents' best efforts at making sure I got tutoring and went to free tutoring sessions at school were pretty much for nothing because I ended up getting a D in AP Calculus junior year of high school, and I had to retake Calculus because that was not going to fly. Still ended up going to college, so... I gotta say, like, all these kids worrying about bees, like, trust me, I've seen worse. But I would have probably been a better studier if I hadn't had a distraction on the internet in my life. You know, our brains are conditioned to chase fun rather than things that are necessary and you need to complete this long-term goal rather than, you know, or I can go play League of Legends with my friends for 4 or 5 hours at a time. Would I have gotten a better school? Maybe. Would I have been a harder worker? I don't know. I think it just ended up being a void to have fun and do other things rather than actually have healthy hobbies. But, I mean, what's done is done, so.
Yeah, I mean, it turned out fine.
And I feel like I think I'm adjusted, mostly, balanced mostly, so.
Yeah, I think it's, like, the same for so many people our age. I don't know.
Yeah, definitely. It's like everyone I know was like, yeah, I spent a lot of time in MySpace and Facebook when I was 13 or so. And I'm like, yeah, that really much, you know, that really feels like where my adolescent years went. Like, I was on the internet. I don't know what other people did, really.
I think other people were on the internet. But it's weird because we interview so many older people that, like, that's not a topic of conversation at all.
Yeah, I definitely feel that because it's like a lot of my coworkers, you know, talk about like, oh, like these are things I like traveled to Belize or something when I was your age. And I'm like, first off, where did you get the money to travel to Belize? And second, I couldn't afford to travel to Belize. So I was just looking at pictures of Belize on Facebook.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Okay. So in middle and high school, like, when did you first become aware of being Asian American? Or it seems like it would be earlier because your parents, like, taught you to be proud of your culture and everything.
Yeah. I think the first time I was really aware of Asianness and kind of how it ended up being synonymous to otherness was when I was in preschool. For Halloween, my parents didn't want to go buy me a costume, so they stuck me in an ao yai, which is a long Vietnamese dress. They got a bamboo dumpling steamer set that, like, was for me to play with, and they just dressed me up in that and sent me to school. And I remember my teacher at the time being like, oh, I didn't know that was a costume. Like, you know, isn't this from your culture? And, like, I understand, obviously, what she meant to say. It was like, wow, this is so special that you wore something that wasn't just bought off the racks at, like, Kmart or something. But it really made me aware of, like, you know, oh, this is central to my sense of self somehow. Wasn't quite sure how. And then when I was in middle school, I made friends who were from all cultures. But I had one friend in particular who used to write Asian pride on everything. And I think it's because she was very much so raised. She was raised in Koreatown, and she was, you know, very big on just being proud of being Korean. And so that was when I really identified Asianness as a race, I think. Like, and it's like, this is a defining aspect of you as a person in your culture. And then by high school, I think Asianness really became something like I consciously thought about. I went to a high school that was social justice and humanities oriented. And so a very big part of your junior year is spent studying racism and how other cultures have become part of and shaped America. We had a whole unit dedicated to just learning about being Asian American. Racism against Asian Americans, Asian American thought, Asian American literature,
and it really all culminated with, like, you know, here are experiences from your Asian American classmates brought and presented to you. Never really thought about race very much up until that point, I think. And that was very much so a turning point to be like, oh, I don't feel alone. And also, you know, oh, my culture is worth studying. I wouldn't say that was not worth studying before then, but it wasn't something that people put emphasis on until then in my life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really awesome that you had that program.
Yeah, it was like a really interesting program. They did like very similar things for Latino culture, Black culture, South Asian, Middle Eastern culture as well. It was a very progressive program, I would say. And I think even though I professionally don't really do a whole lot in that space anymore, I think it really shaped like how I thought about things and also kind of what ended up interesting me once I got to college and needed to pursue a major, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What were the best and worst years of school for you?
I think if I meet someone who actually liked sixth grade, I'd be really, really surprised. Sixth grade was definitely the worst one for me. It was my first year at this predominantly white and Asian school, and the very big difference I noticed was just the class difference between my elementary school and my middle school. At my elementary school, most kids were on free and reduced lunch, and our textbooks were so old, and our teachers were overworked and really underpaid. My middle school was very different. You know, people have the option to go take computer lab classes, and I'm just like, we had like three computers at school. It wasn't abnormal for kids to be throwing lavish birthday parties at my middle school, and I really felt that. Class difference was pretty prevalent. I think this was the age of like Hollister and Abercrombie and like people wearing brands all over themselves. I had a very formative experience in my sixth grade math and science class where I was paired up with one of my good friends, one of the few good friends I had in sixth grade, and two other popular girls in our math class because the numbers were skewed. They couldn't be with their friends or something like that. And I distinctly remember one of the well-off girls in our group, one of the popular girls, looking at me very snottily and asking me, "Why don't you wear Hollister? Are you poor?" And I was just like, first off, manners, and second, I never thought about my clothes as something that could signify class status to other people. My parents taught me, you know, we don't like to buy used clothes, and we don't like you to wear clothes with holes and rips in them, but, I mean, I didn't realize that the shirt I wore signified to them I was poor or something like that. I feel like I had a very snappy answer to that. I think it was just something like, I don't feel a need to wear Hollister or something. Whoa. You know, when you're in sixth grade and you're like, I'm a really spicy person, I can say stuff like this. But that really, I think, formulated a lot of my psychology for the years to come. I constantly sought to prove myself in a way that didn't betray the fact that my parents were working middle class people who, you know, tried so hard to provide for me. And just, you know, they didn't spend their money on fancy clothes or cars or fancy homes or anything like that. You know, they wanted me to have experiences. They the money that, I don't know, these kids' parents were probably paying for Abercrombie and Hollister to make their kids happy, they were instead spending on, you know, saving up for vacation so that I could travel the world when I was a kid, or, you know, buying books because books were a very expensive habit. So yeah, sixth grade, definitely the worst year. I definitely got a lot of snarky comments about like, we don't like you because you're poor, or we don't like you because you don't wear these clothes, and why don't you wear makeup and stuff like that. Very much so tying that, I think. I definitely feel like I got a couple occasional comments that were like, you know, a little bit race-based, where it was like, why aren't you good at math? You know, that's what race is linked to and stereotyped as when you're a child. The best year of my life, though, on the flip side, the end of high school was a really good year for me. I think particularly my senior year of high school,
I had a really good group of close friends at the humanities school I attended. Very large group of friends too. I predominantly hung out with Asian girls and white boys. Some of the other people I was with, you know, were identified as Latino and Black, but for the most part, it was a group of white men and Asian women. I think they really made high school a special experience for me because I was hanging out with all these people who went through similar formative experiences, you know, academic pressure, and also this program that teaches you so much about racism and sexism and other cultures. We had this program that was looking at classism and homophobia in America as well. You don't really survive a really tough, you know, college preparation curriculum that also focuses on so many real world issues without coming out of it feeling like you're very bonded to other people. I think it also helped that this was the group that I spent a lot of time on the internet with. Like we would leave school and we would go home, and then an hour later, all of us would be either simultaneously doing homework and talking at the same time, or we would be playing video games and talking at the same time. People really made the experience for me, I think. School was very much so the kind of place where we could discuss very deep philosophical issues, like, you know, how do you respond to someone who makes a racist comment to you? But at the same time, you know, be a place where I don't remember much about what I learned senior year of high school, but I do remember that the friends were pretty awesome.
Do you still keep in touch?
Oh yeah, I'm actually still dating my high school boyfriend.
Oh,
so there is that. We got together toward the end of senior year of high school, and we dated throughout all of college, and now as adults, like, six years later. So there's that. I went to college with one of my really good friends from high school as well. And then after graduating college, I lived in San Francisco for a year, and I live with my boyfriend and also one of our best friends from high school as well. I don't keep in extremely regular contact with a lot of those folks, but I mean, we still follow each other on Instagram. We still comment on each other's Instagrams, and on the rare occasions that we're all back home in Los Angeles together, we go out. So definitely still kept in touch with many of them, you know, both people who identified as Asian American and people who identify as white.
Mm-hmm. Who were your favorite teachers or the ones that influenced you the most?
I think I took an interest in history as a kid because I have really good history teachers that taught me about how history was in everything. You know, history shapes how society is today. Particularly at my high school, I had very good history teachers who really reinforced for me that history is very much so a living thing. That's why I think I chose to pursue history as a major in college, but it was also a humanities program that focused on sociology a lot, and so I pursued a double major in sociology largely for that reason. The team that really influenced me a lot in high school were my group of junior year high school teachers. They were a very diverse group to begin with, and they taught really complex concepts in very digestible ways. You know, how do you explain colorism to 200 high schoolers who, many of whom, have never even thought about how skin color affects the way they are treated in society? In particular, I had a really good history teacher. His name's Tony Saavedra. He went through the program himself as a high schooler and then came back to teach AP US history. And what he taught was that history and the concepts and the events that happened in history often repeat themselves and often have so much influence on, you know, how society behaves today. Like, you know, some things are very obvious, you know, like the Civil War is linked to the abolition of slavery, is linked to the Jim Crow era, and then, you know, how Black Americans are treated today. Obviously, like, I see this very clearly now as somebody who studied history, but this was not always so obvious to a lot of my classmates.
And I appreciated the fact that he made history so accessible and reframed our thinking around a lot of what we end up learning in elementary school for people who never paid much attention to history before that. And I would credit him as being a very big influence on why I pursued history, particularly the study of race theory and also minority communities and their contributions to shaping American culture as an adult. And I think the teachers who taught sociology concepts in those years too were also so formative to me. They really taught me to think about why is the world the way it is rather than how is the world the way it is and why and like what it is about the world. And I think that question of why is something that I pursue a lot professionally as a journalist. You know, I'm very interested in why things are the way they are, not just, nope, the thing is the way it is and, you know, no question to be asked about it.
Yeah. So what college did you attend?
So I went to the University of California, Santa Barbara, got a degree in history and sociology there with a minor in professional writing.
Okay.
From when I was in high school, I wanted to be a journalist. So really my top choice was to go to the University of Southern California and study journalism. That being AP calculus did not do me very well though. But I ended up going to a UC. So it worked out in that sense, I guess.
Yeah. Okay. So you already knew in high school that you wanted to be a journalist?
Yeah. I knew from when I was a kid that I liked writing. Turns out authors don't get paid a whole lot of money. And that also required me to finish projects, which I never really ever finished any book or fan fiction or anything I wrote. But in eighth grade, I had the fortune over winter break of going to visit Vietnam, Malaysia, and Singapore for a trip with my mom, my aunt, and my grandma. And I picked up two fashion magazines at a kiosk in a store in Malaysia. And I was like really struck by how they wrote about fashion, how they wrote about clothing. By that point in my life, I had definitely been influenced by a few events where people were like, you know, why don't you dress very nicely? You know, I read The Click, Gossip Girl when I was in middle school. So it really cemented for me, oh, you can write about this world. You can write about what's first and new and like verify gossip by being a journalist. I thought I was going to pursue fashion journalism and move to New York. Then I realized I'm not very fashionable. So that really put a damper on things. But I got really interested in writing about news journalism and other things when I was in high school. I had a really excellent journalism teacher who pushed me to attend a summer journalism workshop where I learned the fundamentals of news writing and learned that, you know, people in the industry still believe in journalism as an industry. So I really switched my focus to doing news writing instead. I thought I was going to cover, wanted to cover something that was like the intersection of education and public policy and civil rights. Very different, I guess, in some senses from what I do now. I'm a healthcare reporter and I also write a column on smarter living for the Houston Chronicle now. But there's still policy in that, there's still education in that, mm-hmm. There's still a lot of questions about civil rights, race, immigration, in a lot of the stories that I write. So I've been doing news journalism since I was in high school, effectively, and that's something that I really love, and I enjoy having the privilege of being able to be paid to write about people all day, so.
Yeah. So what is it that makes you passionate about journalism?
There's this very cliche thing, like, you're in journalism to give voice to the voiceless, which, yes, that is very important. I think it's more accurate to say that you're amplifying the voice of people who aren't typically heard in society. But I think what fascinates me about journalism is very much so the first draft of history. And I like having a hand in creating what generations from now people are going to know about as this was how life was like in the late 2010s, 2020s, and so on. What inspires me about journalism is its ability as well to make a difference. Like, I have had so many colleagues write stories that had enormous ramifications on how society has changed. Like, I had a colleague who has since left the Houston Chronicle, but she was one of the first, if not the first reporter to report about family separations at the border under the Trump administration. that's really fundamentally reshaped how people think about immigration policy recently. I aspire to someday be that kind of reporter who writes something that, you know, exposes something that people didn't previously know about, and it really fundamentally shifts the way people think about things and how policy is introduced.
Yeah. So are there any, like, specific journalists that you really look up to?
I think, I'm trying to think, like, if there's any particular one. I mean, I'm really inspired by a lot of different reporters and the way that they write. But I think one of the ones that comes to mind for me is Nicole Hannah-Jones with the New York Times Magazine. I had the privilege of seeing her speak in person here in Houston a few months ago, but last August she spearheaded and published this project called the 1619 Project, which makes the fundamental argument that America was really truly created when colonists brought African slaves over to the U.S. I knew quite a bit about slavery and that history from my high school and my college classes, but, you know, to see that so publicly accessible to people, to see that reshape high school curriculum, middle school curriculum around the country, and really challenge people's assumptions about what they knew about the past was really, really inspiring for me. I don't think I'll ever have the brains to conceive a project the way that she did, but I read it and I was just hooked by the writing, by the very logically sound and, you know, the evidence that she brought up that really cemented her point that, you know, 1619 was truly, you know, when America was founded. You know, the way that American society is today was built off of slaves and the slaves that were brought over in 1619 with that first voyage to America, carrying slaves from, I believe it was West Africa, landed in New England. I think about that project a lot, and I, even though the journalism I do now is quite a bit different than what she published in that project with other writers, you know, it's very different. I cover healthcare, you know, it's not exactly fundamentally re-examining the history of America as we know it. But I think about just so much how people now read that and go, I think very differently about something that we are taught about from when we are little kids. I'm glad that that was published recently, because that's like one of the few things I'm like, this is an example of persuasive and public service journalism. She recently won a Pulitzer Prize for it, and I was like, man, I would have rioted if she didn't. But I mean, it was just so fundamental, I think, to understanding how people of color have had such a huge role in shaping America to this day.
Yeah. If you were to do a project like that, like your old career peak project, what would it be about?
Oh my goodness, I have like a million ideas. I think at some point, I mean, I probably want to be an academic at some point, but I love journalism and I love what I do now, but really I've always been interested in telling the stories of Asian America. I don't get the chance to do it super frequently in my beat just because I cover healthcare institutions, insurance, hospitals, and I also write about, you know, smarter living things like, you know, how do you escape traffic when you're trying to get on 610 at rush hour kind of stories. But I've always been particularly fascinated about how the immigration experience shapes first-generation Asian Americans. You know, our parents' stories are going to disappear eventually if we don't ask them. And I would like to know, especially now that Asian Americans are one of the fastest-growing ethnic groups in the U.S., you know, how is that going to shape American policy and culture for years to come? I don't know the answers to those questions. I'd rather the people tell me the answers to those questions. But ideally, a journalism project I work on in the future is going to have something to do with that.
Mm. So your parents specifically, are they like very forthcoming about when you ask about their stories?
I wish. Sometimes they're better than others. As a kid, I used to ask my mom a lot, like, hey, tell me about when you immigrated here. Tell me about the island that you guys lived on for a few months before you were able to get to the U.S. And I think my parents have a tendency to frame things in a very happy way, or in a very, like, everything was fine and dandy kind of way. Yeah. I remember I once asked my mom about living in Pulau Bidong, which is one of the largest, if not the largest, refugee camp in Malaysia during the Vietnam War era. And I remember her describing it to me as, like, it was one of the happiest times of my life. And I was like, being a war refugee stranded on an island with very little infrastructure was one of the happiest times of your life. And, I mean, keep in mind, I grew up lower to middle class. And for me, I'm like, that sounds awful. Why would you want to live in those situations? But I had to remember, you know, where I come from. You know, I came from a very peaceful childhood. My parents were fairly financially stable when I was a kid. And, you know, my biggest worries were just, like, you know, how is school going to be today, rather than, like, how am I going to eat today? My parents, you know, spent about half of their childhood and young adulthood in what was essentially a perpetual state of war. And, you know, to be free of the concept of war on an island where the only place to go was a place that was ideally going to have opportunity, and hope was really what drove my mom's motivation, my relatives' motivation on that island, you know, that explained to me a lot why, like, you know, it was to her a very happy place, a peaceful place where she just had, you know, she had regular food, no one was persecuting her because she was born the wrong ethnicity. I tried so hard when I was doing this project in undergrad about the persecution of Chinese-Vietnamese in Vietnam during the time of the Vietnam War and after, that I asked her parents so many questions. Like, I would make excuses to go home and see them just so I could, like, record them talking for, like, quite a bit of time. Didn't get a whole lot of recordings out, unfortunately. But I think that when I phrased it as, like, hey, I'm asking you these questions because I need it for an academic project, they're like, okay, whatever gets you the A, like, versus if I were just asking of my own interest, they're gonna be like, I want to know, huh? You don't want to hear these depressing stories. I'm like, I do. I want to hear the full spectrum of stories. I want to hear about when you were happiest and when you hit a low because, you know, you were sad about possibly leaving the home you've only known your whole life. I think as they get older, they're much more willing to open up. In fact, probably after this interview, I need to call my mom anyway, and I'm going to call and bug her again about all these questions. And it's something I definitely bring up every few months to be like, hey, I was just thinking, you know, how often did your mom actually cook when you were a kid, kind of things? And, like, I try to use that to segue into, like, tell me about how you were feeling. I find that my parents, and I don't know if this is a simple, this is something that a lot of other Asian Americans face, but your parents don't always talk about how they feel. They talk about things that happen, the things that are tangible, but they don't talk about the thought processes. They don't talk about the emotions, the feelings, the ups and the downs, the same way that they talk about, yes, and in 1981, I immigrated to Hong Kong. And, you know, I'm like, yes, you immigrated to Hong Kong, but I want to know, what was the boat like? How did you feel? How was it realizing you could only take two of your siblings with you? Love my parents to death, but that is something that I wish they would be more forthcoming with me about.
Yeah, that's, I feel like that's definitely a problem that I face with doing interviews, but, and it's, like, hard because it's the first time you meet someone, but, you know, that's a story for another time.
Definitely.
Okay, so going back to, like, when you first started out in journalism, how did your parents respond to your goals?
I was really fortunate to have had parents who took me seriously from when I was a kid. I don't know if it was just the fact that I've never been good at math, or whatever it is. I just saw that, like many other Asian parents, I see math and science as very, as pathways that could later on lead to a job that could make you financially stable and not have to worry about things. I think people tend to very much so reduce, math and science to, like, you know, saying, like, oh, Asian Americans are good at it. Well, I would say the argument is more, it's clear the link from math and science, or careers that are grounded in math and science, to financial stability? And what parent doesn't want financial stability for their child? What parent doesn't want them to not have to worry about whether or not there's going to be food on the table at the end of the day? But it also helped, I think, that my parents had seen so many of their friends and relatives' kids pursue those math and science degrees and never get a job. So around the time that I started taking school way more seriously was the tail end of the Great Recession. And my parents were just kind of like, well, look at us. We have math and science-ish, industrial-ish jobs. And we were affected by that. And so many people we knew, their kids are graduating college and they don't have those, they don't have those resources and those jobs that they were promised by getting a math and science degree. I think it also helped that my parents saw that I was genuinely passionate about writing, and they were like, you know, we didn't immigrate for our children and our children's children to not be able to pursue the careers that they wanted. I think so much of that has to do with the fact that my dad in particular wanted to pursue a higher education. And for him to be denied that just because of his ethnicity really shaped his outlook on education. He wanted to make sure that no matter what, I was able to go to college and I was able to pursue a dream that I had. I guess it helped that I was never really good at math. And they were like, why would you ever want to make yourself struggle and hate yourself for a career you're not particularly good at and you don't have a particular passion for? I appreciate that about them. Because when I told them, hey, I'm going to major in journalism in college, I think part of it was they were like, okay, but if you find something like a little more stable as an industry later on, can you please do that instead? And the other part of it was like, sure, why not? Make something of yourself out of it. I think my mom takes very great pleasure in when her friends and her relatives are like, your daughter majored in history and sociology? Like, what kind of job can you get with that? And she's like, in her head, she's just like, well, at least my child's employed. What's your child doing? I don't know, they're ever petty. But yeah, like, I never really had any resistance from my parents when I said, hey, I'm going to pursue a career in the humanities rather than a career in sciences or math-related careers. I was very fortunate in that sense that they wanted me to make sure that I wasn't a complete failure at it, but they wanted to make sure that I was happy doing what I was doing.
Mm-hmm. Was there ever a time that you doubted that you would be successful in journalism?
Oh yeah, like I have self-diagnosed myself with imposter syndrome so many times. The thing about the journalism industry is kind of shrinking. Unfortunately, people don't pay for news anymore, and that's always going to be a struggle that people in this industry are going to have. How do you convince people to pay for news and believe in the news media? And definitely there were certain points during college when I was working to get internships where I was just so upset that so many institutions hired their interns based off of if they had a degree in journalism. My school didn't offer one, and so I wasn't able to study that. And also, I didn't exactly attend a school known for turning out journalists. I wanted to attend one of those schools, but A, didn't have the financial means to, and B, I never got accepted to those schools. So it was very frustrating, those first few internships I did in college. I never had a choice. I was always just like, oh, this is the only place that wanted me as an intern. Okay, I'm going to go work there. Even though it's not the hard news internship I really wish I could be doing, it's just going to have to do for now because I don't want to have a summer on my resume where I didn't do anything and I don't have writing clips to back up the fact that I want to be a journalist in the future. It also led to me having to take a couple of unpaid internships because those were the ones that people didn't want later on in the end. And I would work a side job, I would freelance right on the side to make sure I had some sort of income to get food while I was, you know, either living in my parents' house, hoping that like my dad could drive me to my internship the next morning, or, you know, living briefly with my boyfriend for an unpaid internship in San Francisco off of savings that I had saved up from working during the school year. I really thought for a while I wasn't going to make it and my hard work was just like all for nothing. I was really fortunate that I made really good connections through those internships and
through my college journalism career, working at the school newspaper. And later on, people took chances on me, even though my bachelor's degree didn't say journalism on it. I don't think it's anything short of a miracle. A lot of days that I work in such a large newspaper and such in such a supportive environment that really is invested in creating good journals rather than just taking good journalists from other outlets. And then, you know, good journalists who have fancy Ivy League degrees in journalism and stuff like that. So yeah, really, really, I think that drove me to keep working harder so they couldn't say no to me when I keep knocking, being like, hey, I need a job.
Yeah. So personally, what do you think is like the future of journalism?
That's a good question. I think for journalism to survive, people need to be convinced of why journalism is vital. I think people don't realize, you know, you only know the things you know because the news media is there documenting it. I mean, I'm trying to think of an example that is not coronavirus pandemic related. But I mean, I think about like immigration policy and education policy. Like, how do you know what's going on with student loans in America if there aren't journalists around to write about it? Because, I mean, a lot of these places that have to do with student loans don't have vested interest in making sure you know the truth about student loans. They have a vested interest in making money and, you know, ensuring practices that are going to continue to make them money. So there's that. I think the other problem is that, you know, we are living increasingly in a society that is expensive to afford. You know, for some, you know, as a journalist, I often post about how like, hey, subscribe to your local newspapers. We're what makes sure that you know the things you know. But if I'm telling someone, hey, that's going to be $15 a month for you to gain access to our website, well, that's an affordability barrier that the majority of people don't have $15 a month to spend. I mean, I've raised these questions to my managers and like to other journalists in the field, so I don't have any problem saying that in public for eternity on this recording. But I do really feel like it's, you know, we have to convince people why news is worth it, why it's worth that X dollar subscription, why it's worth that X dollar access to make sure that you know what's going on in the world. I mean, I know there's the argument that information should never be limited to those people who just have means, but at the same time, you've got to pay people to make sure that they accurately write down what is happening in the world. I wish I had all the solutions to how the journalism industry is going to survive, but I mean, those are just my observations, really, as a person who's been observant of news media for the better part of 5 or 6 years now, so. Mm-hmm.
So you're in the Asian American Journalists Association?
Yeah, I joined the Asian American Journalists Association, or AAJA, when I was a sophomore in college. I joined because I was applying to internships, and I was like, oh god, they don't know that I'm a journalist. I'm going to go buy this $25 annual fee to be a member of the Asian American Journalists Association. And what I really found was it was a really supportive environment for, you know, journalists who weren't just interested in writing about Asian America. Journalists were interested in writing about anything and everything. But ensuring that our mentors and networks the people who identify as Asian American who already worked in the news industry were able to bring more Asian American journalists into the industry and, you know, write from a perspective that more accurately reflects America's makeup rather than being a, you know, trying to, you know, have a majority white industry. You know, in my opinion, diversity really begets a more accurate portrayal and reflection of how the U.S. is these days. So very thankful to be a member of AHA for that reason.
Mm-hmm. So how are you involved? Like, what are the activities?
Yeah, so for the most part, I just really try to webinars. You know, I have attended one Asian American Journalists Association convention. It's very much so like a trade association. You know, you're just swapping mentorship. You know, mm-hmm. You're making connections and networking. You're finding out about jobs that are open, where people are trying to be as unbiased as possible in hiring.
take a little bit more of an active role in making sure there are those webinars and other like kind of things available for other young Asian American journalists. I mentor younger Asian American journalists through AAJA. I believe this is going to be my second year mentoring younger journalists, but just, you know, answering their questions about like, is there discrimination within the industry? You know, if I am discriminated against, what are my options? And also just building a pipeline of younger journalists to pursue the industry. I think it's always really discouraging to pursue a certain career if you don't have people who look like you and people who you can relate to already in the industry. So I'm trying to make sure that we build our network as much as we can, and also that younger journalists aren't discouraged from pursuing the industry or having a good experience working as reporters.
Yeah. So for you, how has like this Asian American network of journalists and peers like helped you?
It's very nice to be able to say like, hey, I have had this really weird experience where someone mentioned my race randomly during an interview or something. What would you guys do if you were in that situation? If I hadn't been part of AAJA, I don't think I'd know who to text and ask that question to. I rely on them very largely to, you know, have a kind of family of like-minded people who understand the work that I do. Because, I mean, I love my parents, but they're not journalists. They don't get what it's like to be a reporter. And to be able to say, like, hey, I'm facing this really kind of weird, oddly specific to my ethnicity or race experience in the workplace. Do you guys have any advice for this? And aside from that, just being a very, sharing a common experience of identifying as Asian American in the workplace, and just being like, hey, like, you know, we come from similar cultures, we hold similar beliefs, you know, we have similar experiences. Can you mentor me, or can you give me advice on how to get to where you are today?
Mm-hmm. And generally, what are your ambitions with writing?
I used to be one of those people who had a five-year plan, and then, like, life happened, and I was like, five-year plans are overrated. Right now I'm based in Houston. I would like to return to California eventually. I moved here for a fellowship last year, and I'm staying here full time afterward. But I so far feel like, you know, my ambitions are to continue writing, to be a better writer. I'm fortunate to write about something that actually interests me and challenges me every day. And so I would love to continue gaining skills in that. But even after that, you know, I think in the future, I would like to take on a few more academic things with my writing, you know, whether that's teaching the next generation of journalists or whether that's studying media from an academic perspective. I don't know that I necessarily want to become a household name as a journalist or as a reporter the way that people like Bob Woodward and Dan Rather are, but I really do think that I want to write things that have some sort of impact in how people think about the world, or I want to write something that is going to be like a defining snapshot of what this generation and what society the way it is today is like.
Mm-hmm. So how long are you in Houston?
I moved here last August, actually, so I've been here about 9 months or so. I don't know when exactly I'm going to move back to California. You know, I hope to stay here long enough at least to know neighborhoods by name and not have to need Google Maps to go everywhere.
Have you seen any differences between the Asian community in Houston versus California?
I try to get out to a lot of the more Asian communities here in Houston as frequently as I can. I miss feeling like I'm part of a community that Asian Americans are a little more noticeable and prevalent in. So for me, I wish I was more plugged in to Houston's Asian American community, but largely very much so the way I've experienced Asianness here in the community has been through food. Chinatown, it's because I need to go get groceries at the Vietnamese or Chinese supermarket rather than, you know, going to HEB or something like that. But that aside, I feel like the Asian Americans I have met in the course of my reporting and my living here in Houston have largely been people who, like me, are first generation. And so, you know, we experience our Asianness through a very unique lens as opposed to people who immigrated here. I also feel like I meet a lot of Asian Americans who are middle to upper class here rather than, you know, back home. I met people who identified as Asian American from all socioeconomic classes. I don't know. It's cheaper to live in Texas, that's for sure. California, super expensive. Oh my God, that's partially why I live here now. But I feel like the people that I did meet here, you know, are experiencing Asian Americanness from a much more privileged position. You know, we don't worry about things the same way our parents who immigrated from Asia did.
Yeah, I can definitely relate. Like, I really don't know other ways to get involved in the Asian community here besides like going to a restaurant.
Yeah, that's absolutely how I feel. I was like looking for like the Asian American Journalist Association chapter here in Houston. Turns out it's just a Texas-wide chapter. And I'm like, oh, okay, well, that's kind of a problem because Texas is a very large state. And you know, when I lived in San Francisco previously, it was very apparent to me, you know, how I could get involved in the Asian American communities there. I wanted to take Chinese classes again as an adult, but I like missed the enrollment deadline at a local Chinese language center. When I went to Chinatown, I was reporting in Chinatown, and I wasn't just there for the food. I was also there to go to stores. I was also there to go interact with people who had only lived in that Chinese American community their whole life. So, you know, they still spoke very little English. And they, you know, identified first and foremost as Chinese rather than Chinese American. Mm-hmm. I also felt like I met a lot of folks who were immigrants in California rather than here, where I'm meeting mostly people who were either born in the U.S. or raised from a very young age in the U.S. So their experiences were a lot different than mine were.
Mm-hmm. How do you identify yourself as like Chinese American, American?
Yeah, I feel like when people are like, when people are like, where are you from? I'm like, California. That's a stupid question. You know how to rephrase it better. But really when people ask, you know, I say I identify as Asian American first, especially because I grew up in a mixed ethnicity household, but I largely identify with Chinese more than Vietnamese. I think a lot of it is because I still speak Chinese fluently rather than speaking Vietnamese fluently. And I think it's largely because my parents also, you know, mostly cooked Chinese foods when I was a kid. They took me to Chinatown more often than they took me to Little Saigon. I also feel like it was a little reflective of the areas I grew up in. I mean, most of my most of what I remember of Asian culture as a kid was celebrating Chinese holidays and celebrating with Vietnamese friends and having to explain some slightly Chinese things to them. I think my parents just identified more with Chineseness than being Vietnamese.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever wanted to like explore the Vietnamese side more?
Absolutely. I was looking, when I first moved to Houston, for Vietnamese language classes. I found some at HCC, but it like required a lot more hoops than I was willing to jump through to like enroll as a student and stuff like that. I also missed the deadline to enroll. This is a common theme, apparently. And I wanted to see if there were like independent Vietnamese language classes. But I think there's also one hang up for me, which is that I feel kind of embarrassed as an adult to go back and try and relearn Vietnamese, really. Like, if I go to a Vietnamese restaurant in Asiatown here in Houston, I understand perfectly what people are saying at the tables around me, but I'm afraid to converse back to them. And I really don't want to be like, yes, it's me, the child who forgot all the Vietnamese when she was a kid that she'd learned, and now she has to go back and relearn them. But I think it's also just because I have no clue where to start if I were to go back and look for Vietnamese classes. Like, I know to go look at the community colleges, but I don't know that I have the self-motivation in a way to relearn languages. And also just because I would rather be learning Vietnamese in an environment where it's Vietnamese that I'll actually use, rather than like, this is how textbook academics teach Vietnamese.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's a weird embarrassment with like trying to go back and learn something that you feel like you should already know.
Yeah.
And like come from your own.
Yeah, it's like, I speak Cantonese fluently. I would like to take like Cantonese language classes that teach me about business and government and more complicated things. But at the same time, I'm like, why didn't my mom talk about politics more at the dinner table so I could like learn how to say certain things in Cantonese? Like, you know, it took me up until about late last year to nail down how to say like landlord and government and policy in Cantonese. Like, those are words I definitely learned as a kid, but I just, as I got older, like, you know, in my head, it's like, you know, I'd say something in Cantonese and then I would just say government instead of ding fu in the middle of a sentence instead.
Yeah. Okay, so more general, like, wrap up questions. How are you coping with the coronavirus pandemic right now?
I'm so the kind of person who's like, okay, something traumatic is happening, I'm gonna work more. That is very much so me. It is really weird to be 2,000 miles away from your family when something like this is happening, but at the same time, I understand it's also safer for me to be, you know, farther away. I still occasionally go out for work, and so I worry about accidentally becoming a carrier of the virus, and I think that's a fear that would have been amplified if I lived back at home with my parents. It has really helped that my boyfriend, who lives in the San Francisco Bay Area, actually flew out here just before Houston went on lockdown, really, and he's actually kind of been stuck here ever since. I feel really bad for him, but he was like, you know, I'd rather be with you than alone in the Bay Area, or like, you know, living with my roommates but not really going out, you know, not really going to work. He's been working remotely from home, so yeah. I also questionably panic adopted a dog, which was like,
oh my god.
Yeah, I don't know if that was a fully thought through decision, but my roommates and my landlord and my boyfriend supported me in that. So far, that's a lot more work than I imagined. I already knew it was going to be a lot of work. Mm-hmm. I'm now the proud owner of a very cute American Staffordshire Terrier mix, so.
Yay. How has working at the Houston Chronicle changed?
We've been working from home since, I think, the day we all, I'm trying to remember, like, the day we all got sent home. It was weird, because I remember that Sunday the 8th, I got sent out to assignment. I work a Sunday through Thursday shift currently. I got sent out to assignment in Galveston, and I was just like, hey, I texted my boss, and I was like, hey, can I just work from home the rest of the day? I don't want to have to just go into the newsroom for 2 hours, and she was like, yeah, no problem at all. And then I felt sick the next day, I remember. So I stayed home and worked from home that day. And that was when coronavirus was still something kind of far off, but we realized the transmission was a lot more viral and contagious than previously thought to be before. So I had a couple coworkers who were like, half jokingly worried that I contracted something while on assignment. I was like, no, it's not going to be moving this fast. And then the 11th, we all got sent home and started working. I've been back to the office a couple times to get masks and gloves and hand sanitizer for when I go on assignment. Grab my monitor, grab my, what else, like other equipment for my desk, notebooks that I needed with interview information notes and stuff like that. But for the most part, I've been working from home. Working from home is hard because you don't work as efficiently as you do when you have your bosses watching you at all times. I mean, not that they were watching me at all times, but like, you know, there's that. And also, as somebody who is a reporter, I go out in person to interview people a lot. Yeah. And to do a lot of these conversations over the phone has been a challenge because, you know, the details I would write about, oh, you know, their office is filled with robots, or, you know, the way that they talk about their work is so passionate. It's not something that is very accurately or is very detailed and captured on like a FaceTime or a phone call. Mm-hmm. You know, I did phone calls before this, so it's not like it was new to me to do everything by phone call all of a sudden, but it does sometimes feel like, you know, I can't do my job the same way that I did before.
Yeah. Did you say you're still going out on assignments?
Yeah, mostly when it necessitates it. I've really been out like two main times. One was for a story I did on a low-income serving clinic here in Midtown. I live in Midtown. That had started doing drive-through pharmacies, and also were talking about how this pandemic had dealt a very significant financial blow to them. And I wanted to see for myself in person, you know, who are the people who are still having to work during a pandemic, and also, you know, how has your hospital-like services changed ever since everything shut down a month ago? This was in April when I did that story. The other thing was I met two startup founders in person for a story I was working on about how healthcare startups were pivoting to doing mask protection and creating face shields rather than the products that they were originally going to be doing. I got a sense when I was on the phone with those founders, I was like, the story would be just so much richer in color and detail if I were able to meet these people in real life and see the office that they work out of. I did go out on assignment for those, but, you know, masks, gloves, staying 6 feet away from everyone as best I could. I got my temperature checked at the clinic that I went to go work, like went to go on assignment at, because they were like, we're not letting anyone in who tests like 101 degrees. I was like, well, this is also my chance to see if I am possibly carrier of the coronavirus. So
convenient.
Yeah, very convenient.
So how did you meet your partner? What are they like?
Yeah, so he and I went to high school together. Was funny. Like, we met when I was, well, we met in freshman year of high school in our science class, but we only really knew of each other on the periphery. We were very good friends starting in, like, junior or senior year of high school. Like, we just ran in the same circles. And for the most part, I was dating someone else in high school, and then I broke up with, where that person broke up with me in high school, and then, you know, we got to be good friends. I think it really helped to have had a very similar educational and formative experience as he had, because, you know, he was really well aware of, like, you know, racism and sexism and homophobia and all the things that we were talking about in society. And for somebody, so my partner, my boyfriend identifies as white, you know, for him to have some understanding of it and a thorough understanding of it really helped me, because, you know, it felt like I met someone who had very similar views on life and also understanding of kind of how society affects me as a woman of color. I asked him to prom as a friend. We started dating after prom. We have been long distance for almost all of our relationship. We were long distance all 4 years of college. I went to school in Santa Barbara. He went to school 400 miles north in San Francisco. We lived together for a year in San Francisco, where I moved after college. And then I moved here for my job in Houston last August, so we went back to long distance. Temporarily, we are no longer long distance because he is working from home in my dining room most days. So, we've been together for 6 years, predominantly long distance over the internet. We're pretty stable. So,
What have been the most important friendships in your life?
I think my closest friends have mostly been people who can teach me something. Like, I of course I have friends who, you know, like, it's not like I go, hey, like, you teach me something to, you know, be like this or something, but, like, you know, my best friend from college is the first person I ever moved out with. You know, I got randomly assigned a dorm, but, like, it was like I actively sought an apartment, and I was also actively looking for new roommates because my high school best friend was going to study abroad, and so I didn't have roommates. I needed someone to help me financially afford where I was going to live for the next year. She's taught me so much about living with other people. She came from a similar experience where she identifies as first generation, but is also an immigrant herself. She came to the U.S. when she was about five, still talk to her almost every day, even though we now live states apart. But it was always really fascinating, especially you know, to be with somebody, to be really good friends with somebody who identifies as LGBTQ. She identifies as bisexual, but for as long as I've known her, she's dated women, and you know, really being with her through the experience of coming out to her parents, and also navigating the world as a queer woman of color has been a big part of, you know, understanding how much grace she handles everything with, you know, how she thinks deeply about the world. She wasn't in school too when I moved in with her. So also, you know, she was really the first person I knew and was close with who became an adult in that sense, who was done with college. And I think the friends that I've had and the close friendships I've cherished throughout my entire life have also been very similar, but it's like, you are going through something so radically different from me and that I have not either not yet had the chance of having or will never experience the same way that you do. And seeing the way that people carry themselves, really like think critically about how their life experiences are going to be and handle these situations where, you know, there is no manual for how to come out to your parents, for example, just as there is no manual for how to handle when your parent dies when you're in school or young. Obviously don't pick those friends with, you know, knowing that like, hey, you're going to have to experience this at some point in your life. But, you know, the friends who I feel like I am able to, you know, be with and be there for them when they're experiencing those hard times have always been the ones where, you know, I feel like we've bonded very deeply over those things.
Yeah. What are you most proud of accomplishing?
That's a good question. I think for me, getting my first job in journalism was something that I never thought I was going to be able to do. I think when you're a kid and you like fantasize about your career path as an adult, you never really know what it's actually going to be like. I had heard from so many people, it's so hard to break into journalism, and it's so hard, especially for that to be the first job you take out of college. Because I have so many older coworkers and friends who, you know, their first jobs out of college were not the career path they wanted to go down. People who worked in retail for a really long time. People who worked as field organizers for politicians when all they wanted to do was write for a local newspaper. So for my first job out of college to be at a major news organization, covering something that they trusted me to cover was like no small feat for me, honestly. And like, I was really thankful to walk into that newsroom every day. I worked a really awful morning shift. I started work at 6 a.m. every day when I was working in San Francisco, but you know, I wouldn't trade a moment of it because it was like this physical manifestation of like, I have worked for years to get to this spot. And my hard work paid off.
Yeah. And what advice would you give to your younger self or any aspiring journalists?
Number one thing is definitely to just relax. I think I put a lot of like undue pressure on myself, you know, constantly comparing myself. Oh, that's actually the second piece of it. Relax and stop comparing yourself to other people. I love my mom to death, like I said, but she occasionally would be like, you know, you're doing so well because you're not pursuing like biology or other science career paths the way your relatives' kids are. And I always just kind of took that as a challenge and also like used it as a way to measure myself up against other people in the industry. You know, if I met someone at a college journalism convention, I would like track like, oh, what internships do they do? How do they set up their online portfolio? How do they tweet? How do they write their stories? And it really bred unhealthy habits for a little while where I was just like, I am not doing the same things that they are doing to get to the spot that they're at. And not really having regard for the fact that everyone comes from a different place and success doesn't necessarily have to mean you go work at the New York Times straight out of college. When I finally realized that I needed to stop putting pressure on myself, I think I became a much happier person. And that's something that I wish I had instilled within myself from a younger age, because I don't think I'd be struggling with it so much as I have done for much of my adult life.
And B, you know, I didn't really take the time to stop and smell the roses, so to speak. Mm-hmm. I feel like there were a lot of parts of my life where I was too busy working and not relaxing and not enough time spent with friends and family along the way.
Mm-hmm. Okay, awesome. So those are all the questions that I had. Thank you for doing this interview with us.
Yeah, of course. It's always really fun to kind of like talk about what gets you there and kind of how you got there and what makes you tick, so to speak. So it was really, really fun being able to do this interview.